Harper Audio presents 3 Days in January, Dwight Eisenhower's Final Mission, by Bret Baier with Catherine Whitney, read by Bret Baier and Danny Campbell. This is Bret Baier. Introduction: Finding Ike. I put the white gloves on as the librarian came over with the gray cardboard box. She untied the cover flap and slowly lifted out the first folder inside. Her movements were deliberate as she placed the folder on the giant wood table in front of me. On cue, I followed suit by slowly removing the papers from the plastic sheeting inside the folder, trying to mimic her movements. It was then, as I held the final draft of President Dwight D. Eisenhower's farewell speech, that I started truly trying to imagine and describe the closing moments of the 34th president's term, 3 days before the inauguration of the 35th. The typewritten page was clear, but it was filled with pencil markings from President Eisenhower, accents, underlines for emphasis, and additional words or phrases that would make it into the teleprompter version. The top of the page read, "My fellow Americans, 3 days, capitalized, from now, after half a century, underlined, in the service of our country, I shall lay down the responsibilities of office as, in traditional and solemn ceremony, the authority of the presidency is vested in my successor. This evening, capitalized, I come to you with a message of leave-taking and farewell, and to share a few final thoughts with you, my countrymen." Double underline. Reading through the speech with Eisenhower's notations, I could imagine him scribbling the final adjustments at the Theodore Roosevelt desk on January 17, 1961, before preparing to deliver the speech from the Oval Office that night. This moment, holding his speech in my gloved hands, had been 3 years in the making. Every journalistic investigation begins with a flash of curiosity. That happened for me in the spring of 2013, when I rediscovered Dwight D. Eisenhower in a personal way. I had just come off an exciting but brutal year and a half covering the 2012 presidential election. From my daily show every weeknight, moderating debates through the primaries, covering primary and caucus nights, co-anchoring convention coverage, and the general election debates, it all culminated in a long election night that finished with President Barack Obama's re-election by big numbers. The presidential election every 4 years can seem to happen in a fishbowl, with an excessive focus on the daily soundbites. Significant historical references give way to the drama of the trail. But I've always been drawn to the ways our current political debates are informed by the past. Some people look at our nation's history as a series of explosive events and larger-than-life personalities. We easily get sidetracked from the most important stories by the flash, while the true jewels lie undiscovered. So even as I was reporting on the political horse race in 2012, I was thinking about how I could tell a fuller story. And a serendipitous experience a few months after the inauguration opened a door for me. An avid golfer, I received the holy grail of golf invitations in spring 2013 through a friend who is a member of the Augusta National Golf Club in Augusta, Georgia. It was a welcome break. With the CBS Masters theme song playing in my head, I drove down the most famous driveway in golf, Magnolia Lane. Pulling up to the clubhouse and checking in, I found out that by random assignment, I would be staying in the Eisenhower cabin. Ike's cabin, near the 10th tee and the start of the most celebrated back nine in golf, is one of 10 cabins on the golf course and was built especially for President Eisenhower and his family to use on his frequent visits to Augusta, where the president pursued his passion for golf. Reagan and Bush had their ranches, but for Ike, leisure time often involved golf. It was a passion I shared, and I was ecstatic to be at Augusta, and even happier to be bunking in Ike's cabin. To be accurate, it isn't actually a cabin, in the normal sense of the word. It's a three-story White House. The basement floor was used by the Secret Service during Ike's presidency, with spacious, well-appointed rooms on an idyllic setting with back views of the legendary Par 3 course. Surrounded by the most manicured grounds in the country, this was Ike's Augusta White House. A gold eagle sits above the front porch. Ike's influence is on display everywhere at Augusta. In the pro shop stands an old-fashioned, highly polished cracker barrel, a gift to Ike from his Treasury Secretary, George Humphrey, in honor of the many discussions they had about life and national affairs at the golf course. Humphrey told the president their talks reminded him of the old days, when men sat talking around a potbelly stove with a cracker barrel nearby, from which they would grab handfuls of soda crackers for sustenance. Thereafter, while Ike was president, the cracker barrel at Augusta was fully stocked. This homey quality, with the ghosts of the past in the air, was resonant in Ike's cabin. Restless and more than a little awestruck to spend the night there, I poured a glass of wine in the evening and began to wander around the house. I could feel Ike's presence in the cozy, lived-in quality of the place, the personal artifacts and books still on the shelves, and a painting by the president, an amateur artist, that hung above the fireplace, depicting the 16th hole, a par 3 where more than one Masters had taken a thrilling turn. Jack Nicklaus drained a 40-foot putt there in 1975 on his way to a win over Tom Weisskopf and Johnny Miller. Nicklaus stuffed a 5-iron to within 2 feet in 1986, en route to another birdie and his sixth win. Seve Ballesteros four-putted the 16th green in 1988 in a failed bid for a green jacket. And perhaps the most famous shot of all at 16 came from Tiger Woods in 2005, when he holed a seemingly impossible chip shot from well off the green, while CBS announcer Vern Lundquist made the call as the ball rolled toward the cup, hung on the edge, and then dropped into the hole. Here it comes. Oh my goodness. Oh wow. In your life, have you ever seen anything like that? I know my master's history. But what I came to realize that night was how much I didn't understand about President Eisenhower. Soon I found myself totally immersed in what I can only describe as the spirit of Ike. This was new for me. Born a decade after Eisenhower left office, I had never given his administration a lot of consideration. Like most of my generation, I thought the world skipped a beat during Ike's years in its eagerness to move on, accepting JFK's claim of the torch having been passed. By the time I came along, we had turned yet another page and were well into Nixon's first term. My night at the Eisenhower cabin changed that. It was ironic it happened on a golf course, really the golf course, given all the jokes about Ike's devotion to and even obsession with the sport. What wasn't surprising was that a television news anchor would be drawn to the original broadcast president. Eisenhower held the first televised news conference in 1955 and was the first president to be videotaped and broadcast in color in 1958. Thinking about Ike, I sensed there was an untapped wellspring behind the facade. So there I was, getting ready to play what was for me a historic round of golf, where each shot on the course triggered a replay inside my head of a Masters gone by. And I was steeped in another history from more than 50 years ago. I knew there was more to be mined. I just didn't know what. As I played, I admired the Eisenhower tree, a 65-foot loblolly pine located on the 17th hole. Ike hated that tree because he hit it so many times while playing. He even proposed that it be cut down, a suggestion that horrified the club chairman. Nature eventually did the job for him. Nearly a year after my visit, an ice storm damaged the tree so badly it had to be taken down. Today, a beautiful glass-encased cross-section stands in the lobby of the Eisenhower Library, and another at the members' guest area at Augusta National. I left Augusta full of questions, curious about the way our national narrative seemed to slide past Ike, as if he was a mere caretaker in a line of great doers. A cursory review showed that Ike's presidency was actually full of drama in the early years of the Cold War, and the decisions he made affect us even now. I was interested in finding out more, so soon after my trip to Augusta, I traveled to Abilene, Kansas, to visit the Eisenhower Presidential Library, Museum, and Boyhood Home. It is a beautiful and even majestic setting, surrounded by fields of grain and alive with Eisenhower's historic contributions, from his commanding role in the Allied victory over Hitler to his decisive management of Cold War threats during the Soviet rise. The library and museum are built on the site of Ike's childhood home, which sits fully intact on its original lot, a typical modest turn-of-the-century house where you could pile in six boys with beds squeezed into every corner while still leaving space for a piano. The archivist at the library told me that if I wanted to learn more about Eisenhower, there were millions of pages of documents and hundreds of thousands of feet of original film, some of it still unread and unseen. There was even a locked vault containing thousands of pages of material still classified after all these years. Now, my reporter's curiosity was really piqued. Although the library hosts some 200,000 visitors a year, coming from across America and around the world, most Americans will never physically visit the Heartland site. I wanted to bring it to them. As I dug through the files, combed through the oral histories, listened to the tapes, and read the books about Eisenhower's presidency, one reality stood out for me. Here was a man on a mission to save America, who largely succeeded in that endeavor. His was not the dramatic leadership of an era with bombs bursting in midair, but the wise course of a military strategist who rescued the world from that inevitability. He was a leader in the truest sense of the word. And from my perch in the 21st century, I was drawn to the question of what made him great. The historian John Meacham made an observation that hit the mark. Referring to FDR and Churchill, he said, "One of the mysteries of history is why is it that certain moments produce exactly the right human beings?" I came to see that Eisenhower, our 34th president, was such a man. He was the buried treasure of the past century, his influence underappreciated in the clamor of great individuals jockeying for recognition. We easily speak of men like FDR, who led us through a great world war, or Ronald Reagan, who faced off with the Soviet leader Mikhail Gorbachev to help wind down the Cold War. But we dismiss the man whose epic presidency saved the world from nuclear disaster, and in the process created a new narrative about how we can use our power for the greater good. This was the centerpiece of Ike's farewell address, delivered on January 17, 1961, 3 days before John F. Kennedy assumed office. The contrast between the two men was striking. Eisenhower, a man of 70, born in the previous century, now at the end of an illustrious career, and Kennedy, 44, the vigorous spokesman of the next generation. The American people, weary of the world they knew, were captivated by the idea of a different path. Genial, golf-playing Ike became emblematic of the sleepy 1950s, while the 1960s were all about a tanned, urbane, matinee idol president with his gorgeous wife Jackie and two adorable children, tailor-made for the new American marquee. The Kennedys embodied the way America wanted to see itself: young, worldly, smart, and educated. Cool. Ike's acolyte, Richard Nixon, only 4 years Kennedy's senior, was dismissed in the 1960 election as being part of the old order. Ironically, the healthy Nixon was more vigorous than the ailing Kennedy, who we later found out was being assisted in looking strong and healthy for the cameras by a regimen of drugs and a back brace. Yet the media storm around Kennedy was so effusive, so packaged for adulation, that it swept the general public.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.